Hello students, we'll start with session 7 of paper Enzymology and Cellular Metabolism. And this video lecture deals with isolation and purification of enzymes. Okay, in the process of isolation and purification of enzymes, first you have to select rich source of the enzymes. And also you have to localize the enzymes where they are present, whether inside the cell or inside the cell, which are the organelles they are present, or they are in the outside the cells. Okay, so enzymes may be present inside the cell or outside the cell. For example, the enzymes of citric acid cycle, they are present in the mitochondria. Okay, the enzymes of glycolytic pathway are present in cytoplasm, and the enzymes of the electron transport chain, they are present in the ATS complexes, and the transport of nutrients, they are present in the cell membranes. So the first step in isolation and purification of enzymes, after selection of the source, you have to localize the enzymes. The specific localization of the enzymes within the cell, so they'll help to bring the order of metabolic pathway, and also the structure within the cell helped to bring order to the metabolic pathways, and some enzymes reside in specific organelles such as enzymes of cellular respiration, which are being located in the mitochondria. So this is the electromicrograph picture of mitochondria, where you can see the mitochondria here. The enzymes are present, which are actively engaged in the cellular respiration. They are present in the mitochondria. This is the picture which shows the presence of enzymes which are outside the membrane and which are inside the membrane, and also which are anchored in between the lipid bilayer. The proteins which are present outside the membrane, they are eccentric to membrane, and they are present inside the cell. We call them as integral proteins, which are integral to the membrane and intrinsic to membrane proteins. These are intrinsic to membrane proteins, and they are present subunit of it is on the eccentric side, and the part of it is inside the cell. And some of the proteins, they are anchored to the phospholipid bilayer, which are covalently attached to lipid. So this is the first step in isolation and purification. Again, this is a picture which are showing the integral membrane proteins and peripheral membrane proteins, which are bind to the surface of the membrane. Okay, it is a hydrophobic bilayer where you have a membrane proteins, and the peripheral membrane proteins interacts with polar head groups of the lipids. This is the flow chart which explains the steps of protein isolation and purification. That is nothing but the enzyme isolation and purification, because most of the enzymes are proteinaceous in nature. So as I told you earlier, the first step is selection of the source. So you have to select the rich source of the enzyme. It may be present in the animal organ or plant material, or it may be in the microorganism. If you select the animal cell as a source, so because divide of the cell membrane, which is divide of, sorry, sir, that is cell wall. Cell membrane is present in all the living organisms. The cell wall is absent in animal cells. So it is easy to isolate from animal cells. So the next step is cell disruption. It is done by grinding. It is also by, you can do it by enzymatic method and chemical method. But in the case of microorganism, you have to select which are the enzymes which are present in the intracellular or extracellular. So after that, for all these three sources, you have to go for cell disruption. That is, you have to disturb the cells to isolate the enzymes, or you have to precipitate the proteins. So after homogenization, it may be by physical, chemical, or enzymatic. It is also called biological method. You have to go for filtration. So filtration, you can remove the cell debris, concentrate that, by specific method, by applying the specific methods of protein purification, then you go for further the purification step by chromatography. You can freeze dry it, and what you get finally, it is the purified enzymes. The first step, as I told you, it is the homogenization or cell disruption method. So you have to take the cell, plant cell, animal cell or a bacterial cell, you have to disturb to release the intracellular enzyme, maybe by mechanical method, by using some high pressure homogenizers, or by using agitated bead mills, freeze disruption, ultrasonic treatment, enzymatic method of disintegration, precipitation of proteins, organic solvents you can use to precipitate these proteins, organic solvents like ethanol, methanol, isopropanol, acetone, polymers can be used, and sodium sulfate and ammonium sulfate, they are used as a salts to precipitate the proteins by salting out method. And precipitation of nucleic acid is done by alcohol, where nucleic acids are contaminates in the process of protein isolation, and manganese salts, streptomycin sulfate, protamine sulfate, CTAB, that is cetyl trimethyl ammonium bromide, and also other salts which are used in the process of isolation of enzymes. After the cell disruption, so you have specifically you have to go for isolation of protein. So method of isolation of proteins differ from one protein to another because they vary in different properties. Proteins can be isolated on the basis of the following properties. Following properties, the solubility, based on solubility you can go for salting out. Based on molecular size you can go for dialysis, gel filtration chromatography. Okay, dialysis, where the membrane is used, where different cut off size membranes are used and the proteins are separated based on their molecular size and molecular weight, the size and weight. Ionic charge, based on ionic charge, ion exchange chromatography can be employed. Gel electrophoresis, isoelectric focusing can be applied. Based on binding specificity or affinity chromatography, it is in the principle of affinity chromatography is based on their specific biological interaction. Okay. What is salting out? Salting out, most of the proteins are less soluble at high salt concentration. So that this effect, we call it as salting out. That is, the salt concentration at which a protein precipitates differs from one protein to another. And salting out can be used to fractionate proteins. So after that, dialysis can be employed to remove the salts to get a purified protein. So it is a protein molecule around which we have a hydrated shell. If we increase the concentration of the salt, so at certain point of concentration of salt, proteins get, they won't dissolve, they'll get precipitate. Okay, this method is called salting out. Salting out is at a high concentration of added salt lowers the solubility of macromolecule because it competes for solvent needed to salvage the macromolecule. So at high salt removes the salvation sphere from the protein molecule and they come out of the solution. So like that you have salting in also. Salting in is the usage of low concentration of added salt usually increases the solubility of charged macromolecules because the salt screens out the charge-charge interaction. So low salt prevents the aggregation and therefore the precipitation takes place. So again, this is a graph which is showing the salting out method. Okay, at high concentration of the salt, it lowers the solubility of the molecules and these proteins get precipitation. After that, this salting out method, you have to go for dialysis. So dialysis is a technique where proteins are easily separated on the basis of their size. Large proteins can be separated from smaller ones via dialysis. Dialysis tubing with a different pore size allows smaller molecular weight molecules to diffuse through and retaining the larger ones. So this is the picture. We can see here the dialysis, how it is carried out. It is a dialysis bag, is a membrane where the proteins that is along with salting out method, protein is filled in this bag and after if you place it in a distilled water, the smaller size compounds, that is which are the smaller size molecules of the pore size, they'll just diffuse off, and the larger ones where they cannot diffuse, it will be retained in the dialysis bag. So after that you can collect it and go for further purification. So next technique, it is gel filtration. It is also called gel permeation chromatography. So here the separation of protein molecules, it is depends upon the size and their molecular weight. It is also called molecular sieve size exclusion chromatography. The separation is according to difference of size of molecular weight. Okay, here the stationary phase or the it is a column chromatography. It is filled with a matrix of a different size, where the agarose, which is in a fine powder, it is obtained as cefadex. It is available in different cut off size pores. Okay, the beads of hydrated porous polymer is filled in the column, and the mobile phase buffer is added so that it allows the movement of this protein mixture throughout this column, and the separation is based on the size. Here, the larger protein molecules, where they cannot penetrate through the pores, so they'll move in between these stationary porous beads and they elute first. So the place is taken by the proteins which are the less molecular weight than this, and the smaller ones, so they have to go through the porous beads, and it takes longer time to elute from the column. A layer sample on the column, a large protein and the small protein, if it is loaded and add this buffer wash, the proteins, when they move through the column, the larger ones, because of the movement in between the beads, they elute first. Like this, you have to collect the series of fractions and check for your interested proteins which you are going to isolate. What is the application of this gel filtration chromatography? So it is applied for protein fractionation, purification, virus, enzymes, hormones and nucleic acids, and it is also used for determination of molecular weight, globular proteins. So molecular weight is determined by plotting the fractions collected versus the molecular weight. If you load the marker, so you will get identify the molecular weight of the unknown protein. The separation of sugar, proteins, peptides, rubbers and others are also takes place on the basis of their size. This technique can be determined the quaternary structure of purified proteins. Ion exchange chromatography. Ion exchange chromatography is a process that allows the separation of ions and polar molecules based on their affinity to ion exchanger. So it can be used for almost any kind of charged molecule, including the large proteins and smaller nucleotides and amino acids. The cations and anions can be separated using this method. The principle of this ion exchange chromatography, it is based on the reversible electrostatic interaction of ions with the separation matrix. The separation occurs by reversible exchange of ions between the ions present in the solution and those present in the ion exchange resin. Okay, so here two types of ion exchange columns can be employed: cation exchanger and anion exchanger. Cation exchanger exchanges cations and anion exchanger exchanges anions, where the counterions has the different charges. Okay, so like this, depending upon the charges, you can collect the different fractions of the ion exchange chromatography and check for the purified protein which you are going to isolate, or which protein you are interested in isolation. What are the applications of ion exchange chromatography? It is used for softening of water and demineralization and deionization of water, purification of some solutions to be free from ionic impurities, and the separation of inorganic ions. Organic separations, where the mixture of pharmaceutical compounds can also separated. Biochemical separations like isolation of drugs, metabolites from blood and urine, etc., also carried out, and the concentration of ionic solution also can be done. So next technique is electrophoresis. Again, it is based on the migration of charged particles in the electric current. So it literally, the electrophoresis means transport by electricity. The principle of this technique, any charged ion or molecule migrate when placed in the electric field. The rate of migration depend upon its net charge, size, shape and the in the applied electric current. So this is the it is the movement of charges between the electrodes. We can see here both cations and anions are together. When the current is passed, they move towards the opposite poles. So this is how the separation occurs depending upon the charges in proteins in electrophoresis. This is an agarose gel electrophoresis technique usually employed for nucleic acid. For proteins, it is SDS page, okay, where the vertical type of electrophoresis is done. It is a horizontal type, but the procedure is same. Here, it is for larger molecular size protein, you can go for agarose gel electrophoresis, but smaller molecular size proteins, it is polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis. Okay. Here it is an electrophoretic tank and it is connected with a power pack. When the when the connection is done, because of the passage of electric current, the movement of the loaded sample or proteins, it takes place. So after separation, the gel appears like this. We can see here in the first one, it is marker, and these are the ones you are the samples which are loaded. Okay, so by using this technique, you can also determine the molecular weight of unknown protein depending upon their the size of markers and the distance moved, the distance traveled. So here, this band, so if you want to determine the molecular weight of this band, so it will be, you can, through, by looking at the marker, you can say the molecular weight of this band, it is in between 2500 to 2000 base pairs. Okay. So, by plotting the graph, you can identify the molecular weight of unknown proteins. And also, this technique is applied, SDS page is applied to study the different subunits which are present in the protein. What are the application of electrophoresis? Electrophoresis is applied for study of serum protein, lipoprotein analysis, for diagnosis of hemoglobin pathics. That means the disorders related to the hemoglobin. A good example is that in a thalassemia patients where there is a immature formation of globin proteins that directly linked with the movement of the proteins in the electrophoresis. Okay, so based on the movement of these proteins, you can determine the disorders which are related to the hemoglobin. And determination of serum protein phenotypes and micro heterogeneous example, antitrypsin deficiency, all these which are related to genetic disorders can be studied because they vary in the amino acid residue because of the mutation in the gene, they're directly proportional to the charges and their movement. Okay, genotyping of proteins. Okay, and this is one protein which is related to Alzheimer's disease. Okay, small molecules, drugs, steroids. For monitoring of this technique can be employed, and for analysis of cerebrospinal fluid in case of some disorders and urine analysis also we can go for electrophoresis. The next technique is isoelectric focusing. Isoelectric focusing, it is the principle behind this is electrophoresis in a pH gradient, electrophoresis gradient. That is, here the separation is based on their PI. PI is their isoelectric point. The separation method that resolves the protein markers on the basis of their isoelectric point and the marker points. So, I tell you what is isoelectric point. So, it is successfully used in clinical research and agriculture field and agriculture applications. Okay, it is also used for the analysis of blood, serum, muscle extract and seed extracts which are rich in protein. See here, so here the pH paper, or it may, we can use the membranes which has a gradient of pH. So gradient of pH, where you have a low pH, it's acidic condition, and the basic condition, high pH. So here, when the protein sample, when you load it and apply the electric charges, or if you connect it to the power supply, the movement of the protein molecules in this pH gradient, okay, starts, and they'll get precipitate when there is a their PI, that is when they doesn't carry any charge. So that pH at which the proteins does not show movement, they precipitate in the form of a band, it is called isoelectric focusing, and that is the pH we call it as isoionic point of that specific protein. This isoionic point, it varies for each protein molecule depending upon their charges. All the proteins have isoelectric point pH. A procedure to determine the isoelectric point of protein, thus a mixture of proteins can be electrophoresed through a solution having a state of pH gradient in the form of the anode to cathode, and each protein will migrate to a position in a pH gradient according to its isoelectric point. So this is called isoelectric focusing. Protein migrates into the point where its net charge is zero isoelectric pH. So that is called isoelectric focusing. So this technique is applied for separation of proteins, peptides. Okay, it is also used for research in taxonomy, cytology, immunology. Isoelectric focusing, it is compared with the density of band of standard preparation. It is also used in the migration of the gel is compared with the standard preparation. Isoelectric focusing offers an effective alternative to conventional electrophoresis or genetic marker typing. Maybe the last technique, it is the affinity chromatography. Here the separation is based on their specific biological interaction. It is also a column chromatography. Affinity chromatography is a column chromatography where you have, it is filled with a stationary phase along with the ligand. That is, when you are isolating a specific biological molecules, you have to look it for the specific interaction where it interacts. Okay, for example, if you are isolating a hormones, you have to ligate the ligand as receptors, or you can make that particle to specifically interact by making the site exposing that. Okay, so the target protein, the ligand and the affinity resin which is used in the, which is used inside this column, and the resin is fixed, it is packed in the column, and the sample is loaded and the ligand is attached with the resin. Okay, so after elution, that is a change in the pH concentration or change in the buffers, you can elute the specific binded proteins. What are the application of this affinity chromatography? It is used for isolation and purification of all biological macromolecules, and it is used to purify nucleic acid, antibodies, enzymes, etc. And also the biological compounds which bind to a particular substance. For example, in the isolation of mRNA, you have to go for binding of complementary bases. So RNA, mRNA, where it has a polyadenylated tail, so to that complementary base, it is thymine residue, it is attached to the inside the column. Okay, so this is about the isolation and purification of enzymes. So regarding that, you can watch this video. You can clearly understand how this protein purification.
Why do we need purified protein?
One second.
Why do we need purified protein? By analyzing pure protein, we can determine amino acid sequences and investigate a protein's biochemical function. Besides, crystallization of proteins need pure protein. And we can obtain X-ray data from the protein crystals with a picture of tertiary structure, which is the actual functional unit of the protein. For pure protein is so important for further analysis, we will discuss the protein purification methods which usually used. Purified protein contains only one type of protein which we are interested in. At beginning, this protein may be only a tiny fraction of the complex. How could we know we isolate the particular protein we need? We need an assay for some unique identifying property of the protein, so that we can tell when the protein is present or whether this is a target protein. Determining an effective assay is often difficult. For enzymes, which are protein catalysts, the assay is usually based on the reaction that the enzyme catalyzes in the cell. For already known protein, there is a more convenient method. Western blot. We can use specific antibody to analyze the target protein. These methods will be used after the purification process. We'll talk about this later. When you know how to analyze whether your purification process is successful, we can start to purify the protein now. First, the protein need be released from cell. There are several methods to disrupt the cell membrane. Sonication is a common method. Others include French press, enzymatic or chemical cleavage of the cells, and freeze thawing. For larger scale continuous disruption, high pressure homogenization or bead milling are widely used. After that step, the mixture is fractionated by centrifugation. Here, we need to make some trials or dependent on previous experience to make sure the target protein enriched in which component of the fractions. The differential centrifugation yields a dense pellet of heavy material at the bottom of the centrifuge tube and a lighter supernatant above. Then the supernatant is again centrifuged at a greater force to yield yet another pellet and supernatant. In the centrifugation process, the mixture yields several fractions of decreasing density, each still containing hundreds of different proteins, which are subsequently assayed for the further purification. Proteins could be purified according to their basic characteristics, such as solubility, size, charge, and specific binding affinity. Usually, protein mixtures are subjected to a series of separations, each based on a different property to yield a pure protein. Most proteins are less soluble at high salt concentrations, an effect called salting out. The salt concentration at which a protein precipitates differs from one protein to another. Hence, salting out can be used to fractionate proteins. Salting out is also useful for concentrating dilute solutions of proteins, including active fractions obtained from other purification steps. Dialysis can be used to remove the salt in above step. Proteins can be separated from small molecules by dialysis through a semipermeable membrane, such as a cellulose membrane with pores. Proteins have greater dimensions than the pore diameter and are retained inside the dialysis, whereas smaller molecules and ions traverse outside the bag through the pore. However, this process could not distinguish between proteins effectively. Chromatography is the more discriminating separations on the basis of size. The column consists of porous beads made of insoluble but highly hydrated polymers such as dextran or agarose or polyacrylamide. We applied sample on the top of a column. The small molecules can enter the pores of the beads, but large ones cannot. Thus, the small molecule goes both inside and between the beads, whereas large one goes only between the beads. Small molecules flow longer distance than the larger molecules. So, the large molecules flow more rapidly through this column and emerge first. Molecules that are of a size to occasionally enter a bead will flow from the column at an intermediate position, and small molecules, which take a longer, tortuous path, will exit last. Ion exchange chromatography. Proteins may have net positive or negative charge at different pH range. This is another basic rules for protein separate. If a protein has a net positive charge, it will usually bind to a column of beads containing carboxylate groups. Whereas a negatively charged protein will bind to a column of beads containing diethyl aminosyl group. Protein sample loads on the column, a positively charged protein binds to the beads. Another charged protein will flow through this column and emerge first. The positively charged protein, for example, can be eluted by increasing the concentration of sodium chloride or another salt in the eluting buffer because sodium ions compete with positively charged groups on the protein for binding to the column. proteins with less net positive charge released first than the higher charge density proteins. There are lots of ion exchange chromatography. You need to choose suitable chromatography depends on the character of your interested protein. Affinity chromatography. Affinity chromatography is another powerful and generally applicable means of purifying proteins. This technique takes advantage of the high affinity of many proteins for specific chemical groups. For example, Ni polystyrene resin is widely used for the purification of his tag protein. His protein has affinity for Ni polystyrene. When passing a column containing Ni polystyrene, his tagged protein attached to the modified resin, whereas most other proteins do not. Affinity chromatography is a powerful means of isolating transcription factors. A protein mixture is percolated through a column containing specific DNA sequences attached to a matrix. Proteins with a high affinity for the sequence will bind and be retained. After that, the transcription factor could be washed by a high-concentration salt solution. In conclusion, affinity chromatography isolates target protein in three steps. Firstly, attaching the chemical group which could affinity with target protein to the column. Secondly, loading the sample into the column, and let the target protein affinity with chemical group. Thirdly, eluting the target protein by high concentration salt solution or other method to decrease binding affinity. High pressure liquid chromatography. The resolving power of all of the column techniques can be improved substantially through the use of a technique called high-pressure liquid chromatography. This technique could enhance the ability of other columns discussed above. The column materials themselves are much more finely divided and, as a consequence, there are more interaction sites and thus greater resolving power. When using HPLC, the samples load into the column and move through the stationary phase under the pressure. For different material have different affinity with stationary phase, the objects leave the column in different time. The detector obtains various peak signal and each peak represents a different kind of compound. After comparing analysis of these signals, we will know the material contained in the sample. The net result is high resolution as well as rapid separation. After all the purification steps, how could we know our purification scheme is effective? Apart from specific activity rises in each purification step, another method is using electrophoresis to display the target proteins at each step. Proteins can be separated largely on the basis of mass by electrophoresis in a polyacrylamide gel under denaturing conditions. SDS polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis is rapid, sensitive, and capable of a high degree of resolution. We can examine the efficacy of our purification scheme by analyzing a part of each fraction by SDS page. The initial fractions will display dozens to hundreds of proteins. As the purification progresses, the number of bands will diminish, and the prominence of one of the bands should increase. This band will correspond to the protein of interest. In case some protein may have similar weight with the target protein, we need to run isoelectric focusing first. Isoelectric focusing can be combined with SDS page to obtain very high resolution separations. Proteins can also be separated electrophoretically on the basis of their relative contents of acidic and basic residues. The isoelectric point of a protein is the pH at which its net charge is zero. Protein with similar weight are less possible have same pi. Thus, using two-dimensional electrophoresis, proteins have been separated in the horizontal direction on the basis of isoelectric point and in the vertical direction on the basis of mass. Besides quality analysis of protein purification, we also need quantify the target protein at each step. If the target protein is an enzyme, we could determine the protein concentration by enzyme activity. On the other hand, if the target protein doesn't have the enzyme activity, we could semi-quantify the target protein through SDS page gel, which could analysis the percentage of the target protein in total sample. A good purification scheme takes into account both purification levels and yield. A high degree of purification and a poor yield leave little protein with which to experiment. A high yield with low purification leaves many contaminants in the fraction and complicates the interpretation of experiments. Finally, mass spectrometry could determine the target protein mass more precisely. These methods are called matrix-assisted laser desorption ionization and electrospray spectrometry. Using this method, we could learn more about our target protein. We provide.
Okay. Thank you for watching.